Hey friends, welcome to the YouTube channel All About Electronics. So in the previous videos, we have discussed about the Fourier transform. So in this video, we will see some of the useful properties of this Fourier transform. Now typically, this frequency spectra is the complex. That means it has an amplitude as well as the phase. And it can be expressed in this fashion. Now practically, all the signals which we encounter are the real signals. So in the time domain, if this signal g of t is a real signal, then this g of f and g minus f are complex conjugate. And we can easily prove it. So we know that the Fourier transform g of f can be given by this expression. That means g of minus f is equal to integration minus infinity to plus infinity g of t e to the power j times 2 pi ft times dt, right? So now let us take the conjugate of it. That means g star of minus f is equal to minus infinity to plus infinity g of t e to the power minus j times 2 pi ft times dt. Because here, as the signal g of t is real signal, so it will remain as it is. So because of this conjugate, the only change will occur in this exponential. That means if we take the complex conjugate of this g of minus f, then we will get this expression. And in fact, if you see, then it is equal to g of f. That means from this, we can say that when the signal g of t is real, then this gf and g minus f are complex conjugate. And if that is the case, then this amplitude spectrum will be even function, while the phase spectrum will be odd function. So that is the conjugate symmetry of the Fourier transform. Then the next property is the linearity property. So let's say we have one signal g of t, which can be expressed as the linear combination of the g1t and the g2t. Now if the Fourier transform of the signal g1t is g1f and the g2t is g2f, then the Fourier transform of the signal g of t can be expressed as the linear combination of the g1f and the g2f. So that is very basic linearity property of the Fourier transform. Then the next property is the scaling property. So if g of f is the Fourier transform of the signal g of t, then the Fourier transform of the signal g of a t can be given by this expression. That is 1 divided by mod a times g of f divided by a. And here this a is not equal to 0. So let us prove it. So the Fourier transform of the signal g of a t can be given as integration minus infinity to plus infinity g of a t times e to the power minus j times 2 pi f t times dt. And first of all, we will assume that this a is greater than 0. And here, let us say this a t is equal to x. That means t is equal to x divided by a. And from this, if we differentiate it, then we can say that this dt is equal to dx divided by a. So with this substitution, if we see the new limits, then it will remain the same. That means when this t tends to minus infinity, then this x also tends to minus infinity. And similarly, when this t tends to infinity, then this x also tends to infinity. That means the new limit will remain same. So from this, we can say that the Fourier transform of the signal g of a t is equal to minus infinity to plus infinity g of x times 1 divided by a times e to the power minus j times 2 pi f times x divided by a. And here there will be a dx. That is equal to 1 by a times integration minus infinity to plus infinity g of x times e to the power minus j times 2 pi times f divided by a times x times dx. Now normally, the Fourier transform of the signal g of t can be expressed as integration minus infinity to plus infinity g of t times e to the power minus j times 2 pi f t times dt. So here, the variable is x, and instead of f, there is a f divided by a. So from this, we can say that this integration indicates g of f divided by a. That means the Fourier transform of the signal g of a t is equal to 1 divided by A times G of F divided by A. And this is the case when this A is greater than 0. So now let us take the case when this A is less than 0. So once again, let us assume that this AT is equal to X. That means T is equal to X divided by A. And from this, we can say that this DT is equal to DX divided by A. But now, since this A is less than 0, so the integration limit will get reversed. That means whenever this T tends to minus infinity, then this X tends to infinity. And similarly, when this T tends to infinity, then this X tends to minus infinity. So with this substitution, we can say that this Fourier transform of the signal G of AT is equal to integration infinity to minus infinity times G of X divided by A times e to the power minus J times 2 pi times F times X divided by A times DX. And if we reverse the limit, then we can write this expression as minus 1 divided by A times minus infinity to plus infinity G of X times e to the power minus J times 2 pi times F divided by A times X times DX. That is equal to minus 1 divided by A times G of F divided by A. Now here, since this A is less than 0, so this minus 1 divided by A will be positive. And if we want to represent the both cases of A simultaneously, then we can write this Fourier transform of the signal G of AT as 1 divided by mod A times G of F divided by A. So that is the scaling property for the Fourier transform. So it shows that the time compression of the signal represents the spectral expansion, and the time expansion of the signal is actually the spectral compression. That means as the signal expands in the time domain, then in the frequency domain it will get compressed. And vice versa, when the signal gets compressed in the time domain, then in the frequency domain it will get expanded. And intuitively, if you see, if the signal is varying rapidly in the time domain, then it contains the wide range of frequencies. For example, if you take the case of the impulse function, then it contains the all frequencies. So that is the scaling property. Then the next property is the duality property. So let's say we have one rectangular pulse rect of t divided by tau in the time domain. And we know that its Fourier transform will be the sinc function, right? Now if the same sinc function exists in the time domain, then if we take the Fourier transform of that signal, then in the frequency domain, we will get this rectangular function. That means mathematically, if this G of F is the Fourier transform of the signal G of T, then if the same signal exists in the time domain, then its Fourier transform will be equal to G of minus F. And if this function is even function, then this G of minus F will be equal to G of F. So let us prove it. Now we know that if G of F is the Fourier transform of the signal G of T, then this signal G of T can be expressed as integration minus infinity to plus infinity G of F times e to the power J times 2 pi Ft times DF, right? So from this, we can say that G of minus T is equal to integration minus infinity to plus infinity G of F times e to the power minus J times 2 pi Ft times DF. So here, basically this T is replaced by the minus T. Now here, if we replace this T by F, then we can write this expression as G of minus F is equal to integration minus infinity to plus infinity G of T times e to the power minus J times 2 pi Ft times DT. And this expression indicates the Fourier transform of the signal G of T, right? So from this we can say that the Fourier transform of the signal G of T is equal to G of minus F. That means if we have signal G of T and its Fourier transform is equal to G of F, then the Fourier transform of the signal G of T will be equal to G of minus F. So if we have a rectangular function rect of T by tau in the time domain, then in the frequency domain, its frequency spectrum can be given as sinc of pi ft, right? Now, if the same signal exists in the time domain, then it can be expressed as sync of pi t times tau, right? So here, basically, we have replaced this f by t. And if you see this Fourier transform of this signal, then it will be equal to rect of f divided by tau. And here, since this rect function is the even function, so we can say that rect of minus f by tau is equal to rect of f by tau. And that is why there is a no negative sign. So that is the duality principle or the duality property for the Fourier transform. Then the next property is the time shifting property. So according to this property, let's say we have one signal g of t in the time domain. Now if this signal is time shifted by some time t0, then in the frequency domain, its Fourier transform can be given by this expression. So as you can see, because of this time shifting, the amplitude will remain as it is, but additional phase of minus 2 pi times ft naught will get added. So let us prove it. So the Fourier transform of the signal g of t minus t0 can be given as integration minus infinity to plus infinity g of t minus t0 times e to the power minus j times 2 pi ft times dt. Now here, let us substitute this t minus t0 by some another variable. That means t minus t0 is equal to x. So from this, we can say that this dt is equal to dx. And if you see this integration limits, then it will also remain the same. So with this substitution, we can write this expression as integration minus infinity to plus infinity g of x times e to the power minus j times 2 pi f times t naught plus x times dx, because here we have assumed that this t minus t0 is equal to x. That means t will be equal to x plus t0. And if you see over here, this term e to the power minus j times 2 pi f times t naught will be constant. So we can take it out. And we can write this expression as integration minus infinity to plus infinity g of x times e to the power minus j times 2 pi f times x times dx. And this is nothing but the Fourier transform g of f. So we can write this expression as e to the power minus j times 2 pi f times t naught times g of f. So this will be the Fourier transform of the time shifted signal g of t minus t0. Similarly, let us see the frequency shifting property. So let's say the Fourier transform of the signal g of t is equal to g of f. Now if the signal g of t gets multiplied by the complex exponential e to the power j times 2 pi f naught t, then its Fourier transform will be equal to g of f minus f naught. That means we can say that the entire frequency spectrum will get shifted by the f naught. So let us prove it. And for that, let us take the Fourier transform of this term, that is g of t times e to the power j times 2 pi f naught t. So we can write the Fourier transform of this term as integration minus infinity to plus infinity g of t times e to the power j times 2 pi f naught t times e to the power minus j times 2 pi f t times dt. So combining these two exponentials, we can write this expression as integration minus infinity to plus infinity g of t times e to the power minus j times 2 pi times f minus f naught times t. So this term indicates the Fourier transform g of f minus f naught, because here basically instead of f there is a f minus f naught. So it indicates the Fourier transform g of f minus f naught, right? So here in this complex exponential, suppose if we have a negative sign, then its Fourier transform will be equal to g of f plus f naught. But this type of complex exponentials are not a real signal which can be generated. So practically, this frequency shifting is achieved by multiplying the signal g of t with the sinusoids. And in fact, this property is also known as the modulation property. So we know that cos of 2 pi times f naught t can be written as 1 by 2 times e to the power j times 2 pi f naught t plus e to the power minus j times 2 pi f naught t, right? So the Fourier transform of this term, that is g of t times cos of 2 pi f naught t, can be given as 1 half of the Fourier transform of signal g of t times e to the power j times 2 pi f naught t plus Fourier transform of g of t times e to the power minus j times 2 pi f naught t. So as we have just seen, according to the frequency shifting property, the Fourier transform of this term is equal to g of f minus f naught. And similarly, the Fourier transform of this term is equal to g of f plus f naught. So from this, we can say that the Fourier transform of g of t times cos of 2 pi f naught t is equal to 1 half of g of f minus f naught plus g of f plus f naught. And graphically, it can be shown like this. That means if we have a signal g of t, that is the basement signal, and if it is multiplied by some carrier signal cos of 2 pi f naught t, then the entire basement spectrum will get shifted by the frequency f naught. So in the upcoming videos, when we see the different modulation techniques, then we will talk more about it. And in the end, now let us briefly talk about the convolution property. So let's say we have a two signals g1t and the g2t. So according to this convolution property or the convolution theorem, the time convolution of the two signal becomes the multiplication in the frequency domain. Similarly, the multiplication of the two signals in the time domain becomes the convolution in the frequency domain. And this can be easily proved also. So these are the some of the useful properties of the Fourier transform. So in the next video, we will discuss the amplitude modulation. And there you will see that this frequency shifting or this modulation property is very useful. So if you have any question or suggestion, do let me know here in the comment section below. If you like this video, hit the like button and subscribe to the channel for more such videos.